Welcome to The Stitch. I'm Lynn.
And I'm Pam. We're happy you're joining us today.
So this is an online quilting talk show. Join us as we chat about current topics in the quilting world, techniques to improve your own projects, and fun stories about our quilts.
Our episodes come out monthly, complemented by virtual sew-ins and weekly podcasts. You can learn more about at thestitchtvshow.com.
Right.
So what you been doing this month?
That's a good question. I just had a girls weekend that I went out with a couple of friends up to a cabin in the mountains and hung out for a couple of days. I didn't do a lot of sewing though. I taught some classes this month, so that's what I've been up to. I teach a color class, so that's what I've been doing. Nothing, I don't have any major things this month. I know, you've had some stuff.
You can't tell from my tan.
Yeah.
Spent a week at the beach, and this is what I got.
But see, I would be the same way.
I know.
I'm like, oh, look at the sun outside. It's very pretty.
Like, oh, that's a great day to stay in and sew something.
Sew something inside. Yay.
Well, we did have a tropical storm rain on us a couple of the first 2 days, but we had museums and all that. So family vacation, we go and meet my parents in South Carolina, and the kids have a good time. I get asked all the time, like, Pam, you can't swim, and you're afraid to put your face in water. Why do you go to the beach every year? Because I made two people from scratch that love it. So, and I like...
I like the beach.
I like it, too. I mean, and I went out in the ocean, and I got in a pool. You know, I just don't dunk my head underneath.
Well,
just mess up my hair.
Mess up your hair. And you can't do that, right?
So, I mean, well...
I actually like swimming. I like the beach.
Yeah, there was some serious beach hair, don't care, going on.
Goodness. See, I don't have that issue because his mind's like...
I got stopped straight in the grocery store because one day it was so big, I just braided it like on two sides. And I got stopped in the grocery store by a woman who's like, what'd you do to your hair? My hair looks like yours and yours looks good out here. And I'm like, oh, okay. Now, I think also the fact that my daughter we had gone to an arcade and played a lot of games and skee ball and got tickets and turned in for prizes. And, you know, the prizes you can get Tootsie Rolls and, you know, whatever. We had gotten...
plastic rings.
We got a plastic lizard. Which I stuck in my hair when I braided it. And I'm like, I wonder if anyone's going to notice this because it's about the color of my hair.
See, that would freak me out.
Oh, I had to be very conscious about remembering that I put it there so I didn't get home and be like, la, 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 there's a lizard in my hair. So, yeah. But we had a good time.
Yeah, considering I screamed this morning when a bug ran in front of me. So
nice. I have a different reason to scream because I got on the treadmill this morning and you know the story of the basement snake.
Oh, yes.
And the insulation, because our basement's not finished, right behind the TV was a jar. And I'm like, where is he? I would see something like kind of a reflection in the TV in front of the treadmill. And I'd be like, it's a snake. So I don't know where it is. But it took liberties with the insulation in my basement.
That's not cool.
No, and I was prepared to like scream and run off the treadmill.
Yes.
And it would have been like a Bugs Bunny cartoon, but like the puff of smoke and then the me-shaped hole in the wall. I was ready.
Because you don't fall in Bugs Bunny cartoons until you look down.
No, I
and
probably...
then it's
I would have picked up the box labeled TNT. Poof.
Well, okay, here's what I did. Actually, yesterday, I'm a little sore today. No, it was... I don't know what day it was. It was 2 days ago. So I go with my friend up to this North Georgia town, Blue Ridge, and we're looking for houses that she's going to use for her daughter's wedding. So it was like, she had found this house, so we went up to look at it to see how we could set the wedding up, that kind of stuff, you know, where they're going to stand, all that thing. So we got there before the person who was going to open the house for us got there, and we... are walking around outside, looking at the outside. It's next to a river. There's a pool. It's a big porch out back, you know. And I have one of those hammocks that are on a stand. These I apparently should never set in because I don't know how to do a hammock.
It's a skill.
It apparently is. So I sat in the hammock and literally leaned back and very slowly did the backflip. And both my friends are sitting there like, what just happened? So I didn't slam into the floor, into the concrete pad. I just rolled over the beam that, you know, that's what made me sore. So
yeah, we have one of those in my backyard.
It was grace in motion right there.
Yeah, we've got one in my backyard and I can see it from my sewing room.
I can't come to your backyard.
Well, the beauty of it is like my two kids, we'll play with the neighbor's kids who are younger and therefore smaller. And I don't know what the game is called that they do where they put the little kids on and they try and flip them over like it's a roller shade. That happens quite a bit. I see that. And I'm like, I'm sure they'll be fine. They're still wiggling.
There's no blood. We're good.
I don't see any bones. I'm sure they have good insurance.
All right. So what are we going to talk about on our show?
Okay. Well, so this month we are going to be talking about the psychology of quilting. We are going to be talking about designing quilts and collaboration.
Okay. So first let's talk about psychology. There was an article that came out. My cards are all jacked up. There was an article that came out this week from Psychology Today talking about, is quilting an addiction? And so the article talked about how they did research. Well, they did some type of research.
They Googled where some stuff.
They Googled some stuff and said there are a lot of blogs out there that are saying quilts addicting. Quilting's addiction. And I thought, I don't know, I read the article and their major problem with quilting, talking about addiction, was that it was habit forming and that we have stashes. As quilters, apparently we're addicted because we spend time talking about it. I quilt all the time. You quilt all the time. I'm not looking at your thing. So, but they said that the stash, the good things in the article that I thought were important is they talked about how the maker of quilts usually are a lot of times makes quilts for social values.
Yeah.
And that they have a social impact. We had a thing that just went off. It's okay. It's an exciting email. But they have social impact on... Which I think is true, because we are in guilds, and I make placemats for Meals on Wheels. We make quilts for DFACs. We, you know, make pillowcases for Conquer Cancer. So my hobby, my passion, has a social impact in changing. I mean, we make quilts for Wellspring Living, which is to stop human trafficking.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I think that... And then the other thing that they said about it, which I thought was interesting... is that they said that it reduces stress, which I think so.
Yeah.
And unless I have a deadline, and then there's all kinds of stress. It's like, oh my God, Lynn, you gotta get that done. And then, you know, like I am stressed about this a little bit, but.
I don't even know what you're pointing to.
I know.
Look, this one's done.
Yeah, for
and
you.
I did it. You didn't do it. I know.
And that it provides meaning. So it provides meaning to life because it feels like, you know, your quilting is allowing you to have a passion that contributes to society, to the world. So I thought those were positive things about the article. What would you... Because no, I think you read it and I don't think you agree.
I think those are positive things about quilting. This article, I...
You were offended by...
I had feels. I had a lot of feels. I was mad. I was sensitive, and then I felt disrespected.
Oh, okay.
Because, so, anyone that doesn't listen to my podcast would not know, but I have suffered from depression. I had a major episode in college. I had severe postpartum depression after the birth of my first child. And as someone that has experienced legitimate mental health problems, to see the playful use of the word addiction as done by bloggers and Instagram users
Which,
for
yeah,
quilting.
Yeah, we do all the time. Quilters as a culture.
To see that.
Use addiction.
Written about by Psychology Today, which is in theory a legitimate publication focused on mental health issues, that they are diverting attention away from serious issues like actual depression and be like, yeah, quilters so cray cray. Like, I was offended. Like, ridiculous clickbait. And
I well, somebody put it out there and I clicked on it and went, hey, we should talk about
this. I clicked on it because you sent it to me. I'm like, now I have feelings. So I appreciated piddly sample size, N equals 25. Like, that is not a good enough sample size to do any kind of study.
Well,
that's,
apparently
I Googled some
somebody
stuff.
Wrote their thesis or dissertation on a
True.
Quilting topic.
So. In 2011, they cited a study that
they
was done.
Yeah.
And the citations I had before that were from 2000.
And then they quoted Australia. Nothing wrong with Australia, but I'm like, this is for an American audience.
Well, yeah, they did an analysis of...
You're not even looking at our quilt world in the States.
No, but I think Australia is...
I think they're...
It's a different sample. It's more of a self-contained sample. Well, they do get American fabric designers and all of that.
Right.
They are much more of a self-contained, like, quilting.
Well, I get that.
You know,
okay.
So it's an easier study.
It is an easier study than looking
at
the
States. But they looked at two magazines. N equals two in statistics, that is a load of bunk. True. I appreciate, they went through the magazine and like, oh, for the positivity and the talk about quilting and the discussion, they're like, but they noted there was a lot of negative use of language around stash
and
shame.
I have said to teachers and to, other people, like for my hand piecing. Mm-hmm. I took the hand piecing class. I really enjoyed the hand piecing class. My perception before taking the hand piecing class was, I'm allergic to it. And that was tongue in cheek. I'm allergic to it. Mm-hmm. So I remember texting the teacher going, I think you gave me, my allergy shot and I'm good. I'm now not allergic to hand piecing. It was a total...
True, but you have never positioned yourself as a mental health professional.
Well, true. And that's a good
Not
thing.
Even on YouTube. Just saying.
Because YouTube's had so many smart
It's
people.
On the internet. It must be true.
I haven't done a TED Talk because that's when you really,
Oh, then you're totes legit.
Yeah, totes legit. Yeah. So, I don't know. I just thought it was interesting because I did think the last bit of the article talked about little evidence of negative detriment is coming from quilting. I'm like, well, no joke. Really? Duh.
Thanks
and then
for
they
that.
Said the only issue they had with it was... Our culture tends to hide the fabric from their family, that they call their stash, especially, the joke's always like, I snuck it in so my husband couldn't see it. And I'm like, well, it's all out there. I just bring it in. Yeah. I don't even. I buy fabric.
To me, that's now more a reflection on the family dynamic than it is
on
the hobby or compulsion, addiction, whatever word we're using about quilting.
So their criticism was, if you're lying about this, then that's not healthy. And I'm thinking, if you're lying because you buy too much, coffee mugs, you're not healthy. You know what I mean? It's not what you're buying. It's that you're lying to your family about whatever, and you're hiding something.
Yeah.
So that's not healthy. But, I mean, the tongue-in-cheek part of it, I love. I mean, I'm addicted to quilting. I'm sorry. And my guild is my AA. I go to guild meetings. Is that our AA group?
No.
No. Because it doesn't keep me from doing it. It costs me to do more.
No, but I would not joke about that because I know the benefit of 12-step programs for people
true,
with true addiction.
True,
so
true.
That is, and y'all know I love a good joke. That's not a joke that I would make.
Well, no, that's, I mean... But that
and
was
if
their
I have,
point.
I am sorry.
But that was their point of making fun of us because we do use that addiction term about quilting all the time.
And I do think they were like, what's the origin of the word stash when it relates to fabric? And I do think it does tie back to like that dirty secret of the drug stash.
The drug culture.
And I'm like, maybe we need a new name.
I tell you what, I looked for this. There was a lawyer or a judge, I think he was a judge out of Canada somewhere, that wrote this great tongue-in-cheek letter about his wife as a quilter and how he compared her to the drug culture that he was apparently a judge in a drug courtroom kind of thing where he saw those types of cases. He talks about how they talk about addiction and he talked about how, these people refer to it as their stash and how they hide stuff. And he compared that to his wife's quilting. It was very funny. I looked for that letter to read it to you, but I couldn't find it. I was like, oh, I know it's out there. But Google was not my friend. Mm. Sometimes they're mean.
Yeah.
It doesn't get it. So what's your conclusion? You hated the article.
I felt like it was diverting attention from legitimate mental health issues.
I agree.
I felt like it was poking fun at quilters. Because it was some
so you felt
it was some PhD
It was
that
a PhD, yeah.
Was like, well, I'm just going to Google some stuff and make conclusions. And I'm not saying his conclusions were incorrect. I just objected to the article in general because I didn't think it was necessary. Like, it was clickbait.
Oh, it's total. Well,
let's get these 16 million.
It was on Facebook, so of course it's clickbait.
Yeah. You know? Let's get these 16 million quilters in the U.S. to click on this article because Psychology Today needs some ad revenue.
We need 16 million quilters to click on our show.
I mean, that's true.
We should be clickbait. So, but I thought it was clickbait. It was an interesting article. I'm not going to stop using the tongue-in-cheek of, you know, I'm passionate about quilting.
Well, I think passion is one thing. I think addiction is different. I will say the description of his word, like, it's habit forming. Like, well, lots of things are habit forming. Yeah, exercise, doing it every day.
Exercise is not habit forming.
If you do it consistently, and then that's just the thing that you do, and that's what carries you through the days when you don't feel like doing
it. I should have that
habit. I set it up and to my benefit, because between quilting and between getting on the treadmill every morning, that's how I stay off depression meds now.
Well, that's good. I mean, that's awesome. Totally. But I need to do that. I need to exercise.
I'm not judging. Whatever.
I know you're not judging.
Live your life. I don't care.
But, I thought his conclusion was that it doesn't bring negative impact.
And it was like, yeah, quilters are so cute. Like, that's how I felt. You wrote the conclusion. Like, y'all. Darling.
Just don't lie about your stats.
Yeah, don't.
There's your whatever.
There's your takeaway.
There's your takeaway. Don't lie about your stash.
Or hide it at your friend's house and you don't have to lie.
She brought me fabric today, so I was very excited.
Like three pieces. It's totally going in my spreadsheet, by the way.
I don't keep a spreadsheet on my stash. You at least know what your stash consists of.
I know what goes in and out, but I don't know the total. That would be a scary number.
I don't even want to think about that.
Yikes.
Here's what, last night I use comic book backer boards to wrap my fabric in. And last night I'm running out of the big ones and the small ones for the fat quarters. And I looked at it and went, that's sad because that's another 100 backer boards that I've used up of the big ones and 400 of the little ones that I've used up. So they could be used up for a lot of different things, not just me wrapping fabric. Like, I make postcards
make
and do stuff.
Houses. And
I have a...
Tanagrams.
I do, like, card, you know.
Yes. Yeah. Legit.
So, legit. So, and I went... Because that gives you a number. Like, you're like, those were 100 in that pack, and now they're almost gone. What happened? I wrapped fabric around it. I don't know when I bought it, though. It could be, like, 2 years ago I bought that.
I think so.
That's not true, but...
No.
All right, so let's take a break. And we wanted to show you a close-up of the bookshelf quilt behind us. That's for our summer reading program.
Quilt-along. Yeah.
Quilt-along.
We'll be right back. So, on a lighter topic, let's talk a little bit about how we design quilts. Original design, not, I found this neat pattern. Ta-da!
Okay, you want to know how I design quilts?
Yes.
That's a good question, and not one that I think I can answer very well. I usually there's something that inspires me. And since I like mostly art quilts, I do a lot of art stuff. So sometimes it starts with a drawing that I'm interested in or something like that. I have to have a reason to do it. So there's got to be some kind of, you know, goal as in this is for somebody or this is for this show or a challenge.
This is because I liked it. That could be a reason.
I usually don't. I usually have to have more than I just like it.
Like, I like it, and because I like it, I will put it in a show.
Right. Like, and there's a show deadline. I work well, and we've talked about this. I work well with deadlines. But usually, you know, I create, because I was thinking about, I do some stuff on EQ if I'm playing around on the computer, a little stuff on EQ, but I don't know. For me, it's more of a, you know, a challenge or a deadline for a show, or I need to make a quilt for a person and they like this. That's kind of my, you know, I get the design bug in my head.
No, but like, so how do you get it from your head to fabric? Like, what is that?
Fabric. It depends.
If it's the king hands.
Oh, the king hands. That's our favorite. We do the king hands all the time. And those of you who don't know, Outlander, the king, he does the hands like this.
Yes. Mark me.
No, that's Prince Charles.
Okay, well, we can mash up.
The king. All right. No, that's Prince Charles. Don't mess with the wrong queen. King. So how do I do? Well, if it's art stuff, I draw. I draw, like, literally on paper, or I have these big presentation flipboard charts that I'll put up on my design wall, and I'll draw. I can take photos and sketch stuff from photos, so I'll do that a lot. And then I may go to EQ7 if I'm looking for blocks, and I'll design an EQ7. But if it's for an art quilt, I've drawn it and blown it up, and I use my projector a lot, setting my projector up, and I'll either load whatever picture I'm interested in, and please use your own for copyright kind of stuff, but whatever picture or thing that I'm interested in, I'm drawing it from there. And I'm sketching it the size that I want as I've blown it up on my, you know, design wall and on that paper. That's how I did my, we should probably hang that in a couple, or maybe an episode. I did this postcard quilt of a Hawaiian scene, and that's how I did it, is I blew it up and sketched it, and then it was all applique, so. But I draw stuff, and then I go to EQ7, I guess. How do you do it?
There's a lot of math.
I don't deal with math. Like,
that's all I deal with.
Like, literally, I'll cut something and go, I want it about that big. And then I'll figure out the math after that.
Ooh. I got the heebie-jeebies.
There's a quilt behind us right now. That's exactly how I did that quilt. I just cut it out and went, oh, it should be about this big. And then I figure out the math if I want a border or something. Or, like, you just make blocks, and then you go, oh, well, I'm done making blocks. So now we should add a border.
You know what that reminds me of?
And when math gets hard, here's when math gets hard. It's like you're done making blocks, and you're like, oh, I want half square triangle border. And then you go, I need a border to make it this big so that the 2-inch half square triangles come out even. So you have to figure out. So that's when math evolves.
Well, that's, you just put that in EQ7. Be like, well, the center's this. You don't have to design that for blocks.
Yeah.
And you just, like, fiddle with that inner border width. Pro tip. I've done that several times.
Right. So I've done that. I've figured that out. So, but I do. I'm like, well, I'm done making blocks. These are it. This is all the blocks I'm going to get. And I can do math, and I can do math, but it's not, that's not where I start. It's like afterwards, you know, after you've already made the stuff, then you're like, oh, math has to be involved for me to finish. Just saying. I'm bad about estimating fabric.
Yeah. She's like, you could totally make a king-size quilt with 5 yards for the top.
Well, you can. It's just creative. Go ahead.
Imagine an eyelet design where you're like, oh, they're just big holes. I mean, your legs get hot. You want to stick those out from under the covers.
I've seen quilts like that at quilt shows where there's holes in them. So, you know,
I don't think that was the intended design. So this is for a class that I'm taking from Lynn this afternoon. I'm like, reevaluate that decision.
I told you I hadn't made a king size one. So let's be clear. I told you how much fabric for the one I made.
Sample size of 0.
made two of them. There's more than one sample size. Anyway, so how do you design? Because apparently I'm all over the place. Well, I use
we tend to make.
I draw.
Well, no, we make.
I just got fabric.
Different
really.
Types of quilts.
Yeah.
You definitely do more art quilts, and I tend to do more pieced and traditional, maybe with slightly modern-ish flair.
No, you do. I totally agree with that.
So, I mean, mine are very much block-based, or I'm like, okay, I know, or I have made these blocks as part of a program, and I don't like how they've laid them out, so now I have 12 blocks. What should I do with them? And I go, I used to say, like, okay, here's 12-inch blocks, and I would draw it out on graph paper. And then I got EQ7. I'm like, well, this is way easier and much less wasteful of paper. And so I just know, okay, there's 12 blocks and I can play with different settings. And
yeah, because I don't draw stuff out on graph paper ever. I like
I got
graph
some
paper.
Legit, like, good graph paper.
I like good graph
with colored
paper.
Pencils. Ooh.
What's your favorite?
Not my favorite. It's irritating because then I get super into, like, well, this shade of blue colored pencil doesn't match the shade of blue in the fabric. And how do I know it's not going to be jacked up?
Well, EQ7 helps then, because you have lots of choices, and you can download fabrics and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I've done that.
I've designed more quilts in EQ7 than I'll ever make, ever. Because I'm like, oh, well, what if we turn the block this way, or what if we change the colors, or what if we, you know, I'll have 15 designs of one quilt. And I'll never make any of them. But I save them, just in case. And I've had EQ since 5, so... I've got EQ5 designs, EQ6 designs, I got EQ7 designs. I need to figure out how to get them all into 7.
I
know you can do that.
I got EQ7 last year in the droid quilt from our quilt along was the first quilt I designed in EQ.
And it was great.
Boy, have I learned things since then.
Hey, yes. Yeah.
So it's much easier now that I know what the heck I'm doing in there.
So because you design quilts now, do you find it harder to follow a pattern?
No, I find that my understanding of the process of construction helps me compensate for when instructions from others may not be as clear.
Like my instructions.
Your instructions are like, here's some fabric, put it together. Like, girl.
I can do more than that.
No, you've written better. I mean, there's maybe no punctuation, but yeah.
Yeah. Because it's really stream of consciousness with me.
Yeah. But I think that's why we work well together.
Well,
which we'll talk about in the next segment.
Which we'll talk about. Well, I, like, when I'm designing something, though, like, I design it, and then it's like, oh, now what did I do? So then I have to go back and go, okay, this finished at 10 inches, so cut it 10 and a half. You know, which is true. That's how you would do it.
Yes.
So I understand that, but I have to admit, I design it and then go, ooh, maybe I should, you know, after it's done is when I figure out how I did it.
Meanwhile, I am like, cut the fabric, take a picture, sew the first step, take a picture, write it up. And so I'm documenting as I go along.
I try to do that, but I'm not.
Because I know if I don't, I will forget something and be like, and it comes together. Poof.
I
the quilt fairy
that.
Swoops in overnight and makes it for you.
I do try to do that. Now that we're, you know, writing some stuff together, I do try to do something, write it down.
Well, now after the first one I got from you, I'm like.
But here's what I've decided, and we'll show you the first one at some point. But
next month?
Oh,
in July?
Next month, in July. Next month. We do have to make that announcement, too, at the end.
Yes.
About
yes,
the whole
the thing
should watch for the thing. I do realize that I design complicated stuff. Like I'm not like just cut squares and sew them together kind of girl.
But that's how my podcast name came about, Hip to Be a Square, because I was started podcasting 5 years ago, and that's when I transitioned from like a mommy blog to just a quilting blog because I felt like all my mommy blog turned into was like, boy, raising kids is hard. Yeah, whatever. Let's talk about quilts instead. And I named it Hip to Be a Square because I'm like, I'm going to just sew some stuff with squares. Woo! Take the quilt world by storm. And then I was like, boy, that's super boring. After about 6 months and I ran out of and I'm like, let me throw some triangles in there and jazz it up. But that's where the name came from. Plus, I really, that was
I like
that was my theme song as a 10-year-old when the Huey Lewis and the News sports album came out.
To me, it was Huey Lewis and the News.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But there's some copyright stuff happening there.
Of the five concerts I've been to in my entire life, because I'm not a concert goer, I've actually been to a Huey Lewis concert.
I was not allowed. I have been to five concerts as well. What are your five? Let's divert real quick. What are your five?
It's going to be embarrassing.
Oh, girl. Three of mine are the same thing. It wasn't even my choice. So I will top your embarrassing story.
Olivia Newton-John.
Sweet.
Yes, but when she was country before she got physical.
So not even Xanadu?
No.
Oh, Xanadu's the best. Love Xanadu.
John Denver.
Nice. Rainbow Connection.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Wait a minute. I forgot. Well, of course... Huey Lewis in the News. John Denver. Barry Manilow.
No! I may be a fan of Lowe.
Barry Manilow. I saw Barry Manilow. And wait.
There was one recently that you went to with friends of ours, too, recently, according to the production staff who's frantically waving.
I've committed to more to five then, but it's because I got married to my husband and he
makes you.
Yes. Yeah. Prior to him. Oh, and wait, there was one more. Perry Manilow, John Denver, Living You, Hall & Oates. There you go. Hall & Oates. I've seen them in concert. The Big Bang something tour. Big Bang Boom tour or something like that.
Okay.
Okay.
So the first three of mine. Three times. Oak Ridge Boys.
Elvira. There you go.
Each of those three times, we as a pubescent teenage girl, I looked at the bass singer in his white pants and thought, is he wearing underpants? How is his voice so low? All three. With my mother and sister. It was like a family thing at the Busch Gardens near us in Coastal Virginia. And they have a nice outdoor concert space. And we're like, Oak Ridge Boys, let's do it. And singing along. Followed that up with Tiffany.
Oh, wow. You actually saw Tiffany. That's why
not in the mall. Not legit. But yes, I saw Tiffany.
Wow.
I don't think we're alone now. number five, the quintessential college experience. Melissa Etheridge.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
In which I was sitting with two of my friends, also female, out at there's a Lakewood Amphitheater here in the Atlanta area. And you can go up close undercover.
Oh, I went to a concert there. Go ahead.
Another one you forgot?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we were sitting like back on the lawn with our, you know, whatever, towels and whatnot.
We had the picnic up front.
Oh, but wait for it. So then production crew guy walks by and he's like, are you three together? And we're like, okay, we're at a Melissa Etheridge concert. How do we answer this?
Yeah, really.
We were just friends, but we're like, yes. And he's like, great, we have three tickets closer up. Would you like them? And we're like, absolutely. So we like hustle up there. We're like, right. There's another little stage where the singers will sometimes come out and stand in the middle of the crowd. And we're like, right next to that.
That happened to us there.
Yeah.
And it wasn't the production concert. The people sitting next to us, they're like, we really want our friends to sit next to us. We have tickets down front. Do you want to go down there? And they gave us money. Like, here. Okay. It was Brian Setzer.
I don't know who that is.
Yeah, you do. Stray Cat Strut.
Oh, okay.
But it was when he had the big band stuff.
Now, I confess, I also dragged my husband to one concert. Do you remember the oldie station here? And they would do, like, whatever the oldies showcase was. And so it was, like, the Turtles and the Monkees Tribute Band. And I dragged them to that.
The Monkees Tribute Band?
Yeah, I don't remember their name. And a Beatles Tribute Band, I think, called the Roaches.
I'm not your stepping stone. Yes.
I grew up on a heavy diet of
oldies
and
80s. The Monkees was a great show.
Light 80s country. A lot of Crystal Gale. I still know all the words to Islands in the Stream. Still, it's on a playlist, I confess.
All right, we've diverted
Okay, we've
enough.
Diverted. All right, back to
okay,
designing.
Okay, back to designing.
I've
only got cooler content since I met my husband. But, okay.
Mine have gotten lamer.
All right, so let's look at this quilt.
Yes.
A close-up of the quilt behind us.
A little more.
Get
everyone excited about the quilting
detail. And then
we're
going to talk about collaborating. Because that's really what Pam and I do the most, and I think that that's a good topic.
Well, I do think we just shoot the breeze a lot, too. But we'll be right back.
Okay, we're back, and we're going to talk about collaboration. So...
Yeah. This is me not collaborating.
No, we're not. So, what do you think when I say collaboration, what do you think?
I think it could be collaboration in design. It could be collaboration in execution, which I think are different things.
I agree. I completely agree.
Because, admittedly, it is a very solitary thing to sit at one's machine and sew things. Like, it's not like... You're over there, like, helping push it through under the needle, you know?
Well, I agree with that. I think in quilting world, you know, collaboration on a quilt was very common, mm-hmm. especially when people were hand quilting.
Yeah. With bees.
With bees. Anyway. Boots and boots and pants. All right, yeah. So what's important to you about collaboration?
I feel like...
Feelings.
I think it's... I appreciate...
I hope they're not psychology feelings.
No, I'm over those.
Okay.
I've done throwing things. I think it's that additional perspective that enriches things. So one of the things I appreciate about you is like, I will approach a quilt and be like, well, I'm going to have a white background because that's the easy thing. Whereas you bring in additional color and so much more construction value and like, oh, this color works with this. And it's things that I wouldn't even thought of putting together. Like, unless I see it presented in a fabric that someone else has designed. Because I will frequently be like, oh, here's a fabric that I like. Oh, it has these colors in it, and I will build a quilt around those. Right. You will just pick stuff from scratch and be like, kabam! And I'm like, oh, that is amazing.
Well, yeah, and I think that that's important in collaboration, but I really think what I put down was the most important when we work together on projects, or and not just in quilts, but on projects, because... You know,
this is a project right here.
Yeah, this is a project right here. I think the most important thing is to listen. You've got to listen to the people you're collaborating with. You've got to hear their perspective. You've got to be open to their perspective. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you need to speak up for your own voice.
Yeah.
You know, there have been times when you and I have been talking about stuff. I'm like, look, I'm not good at that. And I tell you, like, I stink at that really bad. So I need your help. And here's how I need your help. You've got to be open when you're listening to. And I think this on any collaboration, whether it's putting the show together or putting, you know, quilt tops together or, you know, collaborating on. Like, I'll be designing something and I'll send her pictures. What do you think about this? And I'll send her three different, you know, fabric choices. I'm thinking this, this, or this. Which one do you like? And I want to hear what she says. Now, I don't always do what she says, but... No,
she comes back with some magical fourth thing. Like, wasn't even an option.
I just said her.
I do the same thing. I'm like, dear internet, yeah. Vote on these three things. Ha, surprise. Wait for the fourth one.
Didn't like that. But I think in a relationship that you have with people and with working in collaboration, like, you have to always honor them. Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, that's important. Like, if I'm not honoring you and honoring the people who I'm working with, I'm not doing my job.
Well, and if you didn't want my opinion, you shouldn't have asked for it.
Right.
You know?
And I've got to be ready for whatever your opinion is. Like, and I think in any healthy, good relationship, you can't have, you know, you can't have the carrot and stick mentality. Well, if she agrees with me, that's good. That's carrot. And if she disagrees with me, then I'm going to punish her later. That's stupid. You know, you can't hold, you've got to go, okay, you didn't like that color. My life is not going to end.
You're being very dramatic. I didn't know there were sticks.
But no, I think in relationships...
Episode 11,
do.
Now there's sticks? What?
No, I think in relationships and working with people and collaborating with people, it's not a competition. It's not a, I'm better than you, or, you know what I mean? And I've been in... situations where it's like, seriously, you know, you're valuable, and why are people getting upset about I like orange? I don't know.
Are you talking about the time I called you crying? about a quilt.
No, I wasn't talking about that.
I did feel like life and death. Like, we're going to track it up.
We didn't. It looks amazing. It looks absolutely incredible. But no, I think that that's, for me, when I think about collaboration, I'm thinking about the relationship involved in collaborating with people. I'm thinking about what value I add and how, you know, I honor that person and what they're giving back to me. Yeah, that's what I think about.
Can I just say, I am delighted by how different our perspectives are on both the previous topic and this one, because I was like, mechanically, how do you design a quilt? And now collaboration, I'm like, is someone doing the top and someone else is doing the quilting? Like, I am so process-oriented. I'm like, feelings, psh, whatever. We got quilts to make. And all my notes are like, actual physical making of a quilt. And you're like, feelings and listening. And I'm like, whatever. And that's why we work well together.
I was surprised we get anything done. Well, when I have feelings, you don't. And then when you have feelings, I'm good. So it works out. It's a balance.
Good news. One of us is always emotional.
That's probably true. I have called you going, I don't think this is going to work.
Shut up and quilt.
Would you just get that done? No, but I think that's...
No, legitimately, you've called me and be like, I don't know how to start this quilt. It's been on the long arc for days. And I'm like, start. Just start and it'll happen. Just do it.
Yeah. I do need that kick in the pants, though. I really do. I need someone to say, would you
apparently
just...
a stick.
I need someone to say... Because I think as an artist, to me, the most intimidating thing is the white page.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
It's like that first mark, that first, you know, and as a long arm quilter, the first stitch is the most intimidating.
I mean, plus you got to bury those threads. That's the worst.
That's the worst. Burying threads. You just figure out how to go off the edge and then you don't have to bury a thread.
It's the best.
That's why you do it. I'm just saying. Judy Matson didn't bury threads. She said that in class. I was very excited to hear that. Yay. Well, she does on like show quilts. Yeah, really. All right, but what's important to you when collaborating?
Well, I think it, you know, I always look at it as like, well, so collaboration, I mean, so that implies compromise. It implies division of labor. And you can't get caught up in like, is it a fair division? Like, did you do 52% of the work and I did
40%?
You know, whatever, you know. I have grown enough as a person to not detail that much math into it.
Do I have more lines than
you?
Hit me up
in my 20s, I would have been like, my sister borrowed my shirt 3 times and I didn't borrow hers but once. So clearly life is not fair. Like, that was me as a teenager and in my 20s. So glad I grew up.
Yeah.
It's much less stressful. Just be like, yeah, let it go.
Well, I think it's important to work with each other's strengths.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's some things I'm good at. There's some things you're better at. And, you know, we try to figure out those strengths and work with those. And I love it. I love it that we have different perspectives.
Yeah.
Because that makes me better. Because I hear your voice and I'm like, oh, she's right. I mean, I was designing, and this is a perfect example. We were designing a quilt together and I kind of did the major design and we've done 4 versions of it. And so one of the version I did, I picked out an accent color and she goes, no, it needs to be this green. And I went, and she was totally right. I went and bought the right green color and it looks great. And it was because I had to hear that voice. I had to be open to that. Whereas if I got all cut up and, you know, well, I'm the one who teaches color class. Yeah, that's stupid. If I don't hear your voice, I'm not learning.
Related,
anything.
I can't believe that I like actually won a color argument, so I'm gonna note that in the scorecard.
Check. It wasn't an argument. We don't argue about stuff, though.
Not really.
No.
We're just like, yeah. Good luck with your opinion. That's cute.
That's cute. No, but you gotta be okay when you're wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I'm okay with it.
Yeah, I've kind of let that go. So much of stuff in my day job has been like, I'm not going to fight with these people about this. We'll do it your way. If it doesn't work, we'll do it again. The right way.
My way.
No, but it's more as long as the sum total energy around a project, and this goes for my day job or in quilting, is forward progress, like the details and the minutiae of it, eh.
Yeah, I'm totally the kind of person when I lead a project is, here's the end goal, and how you get there, if you're a part of that, I'm good with.
Yeah.
Just as long as you get to the end goal. Like, we got a show.
We don't just have a pile of fabric.
Yeah. As long as we end up with a quilt, that'll be good.
Yeah.
Now, how you choose to cut it or what ruler you use or, you know, all that kind of stuff, I don't care about. You know, I do care about, I mean, if we're talking about a quilt and it's going to be for whatever, you know, you want good technique and, you know, you don't want it to look jacked up.
Well, no. You don't collaborate with people with jacked up quilts.
Well, then I'm out. Because I've made some jacked up quilts, so.
Oh, girl.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, we'll have
that. But I think that, okay, so for me, collaboration, you got to listen, be open, speak up when you need to have a voice.
Okay.
But do it non-judgmentally, you know. That's super important for me.
There's a very good example of collaboration and how it works in the real world in a fiction universe.
In a fiction universe.
I know, but it's perfect. So it's. Marie Bostwick, who writes novels and frequently brings quilting into her novels, has done the Cobble Court Quilter series. I don't know if you've read them. They're very good. Very good at character development. And there's kind of this offshoot about one particular character called Mary Dell. And she is kind of a larger-than-life personality from Texas. And she loves designing quilts. She has horrible color sense. Horrible. Like, everything looks like clown vomit. So she gets her son's help to pick colors. So she designs the quilt, and her son's like, oh, you know, don't put those colors together. And he picks the colors for her. And so while he's not a quilter, he brings that color sense to her that improves. And that is how collaboration should work.
Oh, I totally agree. Like, you're bringing something to the table that I can't bring, and it's going to add value to it.
Yeah.
And make it better. And then our end product will be very much better than individually. So, yeah.
Definitely. So speaking of that, our big announcement.
So we have been designing quilts for the last, I don't know, 6 months? Longer, probably.
Possibly longer than that.
I've had this one quilt for a while. But it needed a lot of help in the instruction. Because, again, I did it. And then had to figure out how I did it.
I was like, I don't think that...
Yeah, well, we're
20
not
fat quarters is the same as a yard and a half of fabric.
Right, it's not.
That math.
It's not. So, I'm going to say it was a typo, but...
Sure, yeah.
Go with that. So, we are launching our fabric... We are launching our pattern design line in July. I don't remember what day.
We are having a launch event July 16th at Red Hen Fabrics. That's a Saturday. Time is still being worked out.
Right.
We think it will be when the shop is actually open for the day. But if you are local to the Atlanta area, please stop by.
Yes.
July 16th at Red Hen in Marietta, Georgia. There may or may not be some 80s music.
I think there will be.
I think
we'll have to have a Barry Manilow now.
So the one thing that we've done with our quilts that I really like is take an inspiration from pop culture that was prominent when we were growing up. So we have thrown out some 80s references. Like, Tiffany alone should let you know that I'm a child of the 80s.
And what's cool about all our quilt designs is we are giving you playlists.
Either a music playlist or movies or TV shows to watch while you construct it.
Right.
Possibly both. They're fun. They're fun patterns. And there's a range of techniques because not everyone is an adventurous beginner. Some people are not adventurous intermediate or advanced quilters. They're like, I don't want adventure. But a range of techniques, and we are in the pattern production process, and we're starting with 3 patterns, and then we'll have more follow after that. So we definitely hope those of you in the Atlanta area will join us in person. We are doing our virtual stitch-in the night before.
Right.
So there will be kind of a mini preview launch music kind of thing happening there.
Yay! But it was very exciting, and we've been working on this for a while, and we wanted to share it with everybody and let you all know that we're planning our launch party. And so you will have official stitch patterns available soon. And they'll be available on our website starting July 16th.
Yep.
So, well, that's all we have for the show today. This month is brought to you by 77 Peaches Enterprises, your one-stop shop for creative support.
We'd like to thank 77 Peaches, Big Think Productions, Cotton Art Studio, and Hip to Be a Square for being part of The Stitch. You can find links to their sites on our show site, thestitchtvshow.com.
So that's all we've got for this episode. If you enjoyed the show, please like us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Google+, share it with your friends.
Remember, the next virtual sew-in's Friday, July 15th, 7 p.m. U.S. Eastern, broadcast on our channel here on YouTube and on Google+. My podcast, Hip to Be a Square, will be out every Friday.
And you can email us with any questions or comments at info@thestitchtvshow.com.
All those details and more can be found on our website, thestitchtvshow.com. Tune in next month for more quilting chat with friends.